Today we're talking about Facebook, and one of the first videos that Mark Zuckerberg probably won't harass me with notifications to promote. That's right, Facebook, a company that famously asked itself the question,
$1 million isn't cool, you know what's cool?
Probably not $5 billion in fines from the FTC over privacy problems. On the bright side, it might be good to have finally found a social network that's better at listening than it is at talking. Today I want to talk about two things. First, what Facebook did wrong, because you don't just rack up $5 billion in fines by jaywalking. To put this in perspective, that's how much we fined Goldman Sachs for ruining our economy in 2008. So what the heck did you guys do? If you're not convinced this is a big fine yet, here's a list of the largest corporate fines from 2018 internationally. The biggest fine is still smaller than what Facebook is currently facing. So that's the first thing we're going to be talking about, but there's a larger conversation to be had here too, because people from both sides of the aisle are coming together to hit the Facebook dislike button, specifically on the grounds of privacy. First though, this $5 billion fine, a record penalty by the Federal Trade Commission against a technology company. What did they do, kill someone? Well, not exactly.
The FTC did put the Facebook under a consent decree in 2011 because it had previously allowed user data to be shared without getting consent from the users. And so now they're required, before they share any data with third parties, to make sure that people are able to give what they call explicit informed consent.
And then they proceeded to immediately do the exact opposite of that. The first problem that becomes very apparent when you start researching this is that we currently have no federal data privacy laws. Yeah, that sounds like it could be a problem when you're trying to enforce data privacy laws. We'll get to that in the second half of the show. The only reason any of this happened is that in 2011, Facebook signed a consent decree because they were being investigated for, wow, failing to keep their privacy promises. I'd say I'm starting to see a pattern here, except I think a pattern requires there be any variation. Now things right here can get unnecessarily complicated when explaining this consent decree, unless of course you're a lawyer getting paid billions to represent Facebook, but basically they had to obtain consumers' affirmative express consent before enacting changes that override their privacy preferences, basically clicking the yes button. Unfortunately for Facebook, they have a track record for getting consent about as often as a frat bro, and they couldn't reach that incredibly low bar. So why $50 billion? Well, Facebook's consent decree says that the company could be fined as much as $16,000 per day for each violation, and there were a ton of well-documented, long-lasting violations. I mean, the whole reason they got caught was...
The Borough of Washington, D.C. filed a lawsuit Wednesday against Facebook over the Cambridge Analytica scandal. Prosecutors are accusing the social media company of misleading users about the security of their data.
Yeah, after the Cambridge Analytica scandal, the FTC looked at each other and said, hey, you know that company that we made sign a privacy agreement after they violated their previous privacy agreement? You don't think they're violating this privacy agreement, do you? Well, there were a few high-profile whoopsie-daisy cases out there, like the time they changed the privacy settings for as many as 14 million people without their knowledge, or the time they accidentally unblocked people that hundreds of thousands of users had blocked. Wait, what? So she didn't want to give me a second chance? Darn. Well, thanks for trying, Zuckerberg. Because of these problems and smaller issues like them, well, the FTC case got very expensive very quickly. So this brings us to the broader question of the second half of this show. While Facebook is kind of viewed as the de facto representative of websites doing shady stuff with your personal data, getting dragged into congressional testimony to speak for all the shady social media business dealings out there, they are by no means the only perpetrators out there. Being that there are currently no federal laws out protecting our data, but rather state-by-state laws, we're seeing something that we're not used to. Bipartisan support for ideas. What? Awesome! Ted Cruz and Elizabeth Warren are currently working together to break up Facebook and other tech monopolies, which is a bit only tangentially related to what we're talking about today, but I thought it was deserving of a quick shout-out. More to the point, though, Minnesota Democrat Amy Klobuchar, hey, I've heard of her, and Louisiana Republican John Not F. Kennedy are working together on the Social Media Privacy Protection and Consumer Rights Act of 2019.
We came together across the aisle. We may not agree on every judge, but we agree on this, and that is that we should protect Americans' privacy. And what our bill simply does is say, hey, it's got to be in plain language. You should be able to opt out if you don't want to have your data shared. And then if there is a breach, like what we just saw in the last week with Apple, or what we saw with Facebook as several times over the last few months, it's that you've got to find out about it within 72 hours.
It's not hard to imagine the one thing that can unite a room full of old people is hatred of new technology. I'd like to introduce an act to make it so my grandson doesn't spend all day on his cell phone making vines and hanging out on Twitter. Sounds like a good bill. Can you fax it to my office? First, I think I'd tap on the brakes a little bit, calling this bill simple language. It's still 16 pages of legalese. Luckily for me, that's a language I'm comfortable saying I'm conversational in. The basics of this first federal bill to protect personal data are, first, a website has to notify a user within 72 hours of becoming aware that the user's data has been transmitted in violation of the security platform. Yeah, because it's the first bill of its kind, you get to put the super obvious who could be against that stuff in there. This would protect from things like...
It's one of the largest internet security break-ins in history. Sony knew the network had been hacked on April the 19th. It shut it down immediately. But it was a week later before it told the public there was a problem.
Yeah, it feels like there should be a law against that. Well, here you go. In this case, you'd have to notify the user of the transmission, give the user the option to prohibit the operator from collecting and using your personal data, which I'm guessing most people would opt into considering they just had a massive security whoopsie-daisy. This would include the deletion of all previous personal data collected and the stopping of future personal data collection. Third, you'd have to give a copy of the personal data that the operator has processed free of charge. Although, could you imagine if they tried to charge you for that? Hey, we got into this business to sell your data. What do you think? It's free all of a sudden? Lastly, they have to offer the user the option to close his or her account. And he doesn't stick the landing on that pattern. Darn, sorry about that. Now, this process might sound super unimportant to you, but if you go back to what Facebook is in trouble for, this would cover not only the hacks, but also the Cambridge Analytica issue, the whoops unblocked all the people you blocked. You might want a heads up before that creepy guy from Tinder likes a swimsuit picture of yours from 10 years ago. And all the other privacy problems that were violating of the privacy policies and terms of agreements. It's also important because, and I could shout this from the rooftops, but companies aren't currently required by federal law to alert users if their data has been stolen or improperly removed from a platform. Nor are they required to share what information they collect on people or how it's used. If there was such a law, your inbox would probably be blowing up all the time because these companies are being hacked like teenagers in a Friday the 13th movie. This brings us to the next big thing in the bill, which is...
I think that what we're trying to do is just give some citizens some power here to say, we know you can do all this stuff to me, but I don't want you to do it. I want to take back some of my power over my own information, so you can't do it.
And then they're going to say, well, then you can't talk to your friends. You can't see your friends' photos unless you check the box, and yeah, you just, you know, you're going to not have...
Not if they have competition. Not if they have competition.
Yes, even I, a guy who reads congressional bills for fun, takes one look at those terms and conditions and is scrolling for the fastest way to get to the continue button. Now, this section does contain some incredibly subjective sections. It has to be easily accessible, reasonable length, and clear, concise, and well-organized. All descriptions have seen enough Supreme Court cases to know that if you ever tried to prosecute, you'd end up with some lawyer somewhere saying, Your Honor, us using size 1 font was just an effort to get it all to fit on one page, for the convenience of the reader. And I thought that us copying the entirety of War and Peace in the middle of our privacy section was key to understanding our sale of private data. You would have to admit it's a good text, right? although it does contain some important sections, such as giving users the right to opt out of having certain data types of their data be sold, and mandating that they give you the opportunity to get a list of each person that received the personal data from the operator for business purposes, whether through sale or by other means. Boy, would that be a fun list to have. Except it might be hard to read considering... Wait, half these names are in Russian and Mandarin. It does say that if you opt out of certain data being collected, the website has the right to ban you from certain parts of the experience. But, I mean, that kind of makes sense. This is how they make their money. Of course, this section is hotly debated.
I think that what we're trying to do is just give some citizens some power here to say, we know you can do all this stuff to me, but I don't want you to do it. I want to take back some of my power over my own information so you can't do it.
And then they're going to say, well, then you can't talk to your friends. You can't see your friends' photos unless you check the box. And yeah, you just, you know, you're going to not have
it. Not if they have competition. Not if they have competition.
Now to the last important piece of the puzzle, enforcement. Not to be that guy, but, oh wow, a set of new promises we're making tech companies agree to? They always keep those promises. Oh wait, what got us talking about this again? Right. This would allow enforcement through the Federal Trade Commission under the Communications Act of 1934. Wow, a 1934 Communications Act. Wouldn't that regulate Morse code? Anyway, this violation of privacy laws would fall under the Unfair or Deceptive Acts section of the Federal Communications Commission. Also, if a state catches any company violating this act, they can bring a civil suit. So all those states' rights people, they didn't forget you. In closing, the only reason Facebook is in trouble right now is that they signed an agreement in 2011 saying that they wouldn't change your privacy settings without your consent. And then they changed to your privacy settings without your consent. This new law is the first in trying to give people some agency over their data on a federal level. Oh man, after reporting this story, I need to get a pipe, a robe, a comfy chair, and start reading through an intense backlog of user agreements. Remember to share this on Facebook and Google-owned YouTube, because let's stick it to the man from the inside. Lastly, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the left of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.